to worship at Grace Lutheran Church for Sunday, August 30th, the 13th Sunday after Pentecost. We begin with our prelude. Good morning, and welcome to Grace Lutheran Church for Sunday, August 30th, the 13th Sunday after Pentecost. And we are overjoyed to have you with us here in worship today. A few announcements before we begin. Tonight, by which I mean Sunday night at 6 p.m., we are having our first socially distanced fellowship gathering. We were going to do it Saturday night, but the weather was kind of iffy, so we went with the rain date of Sunday. Sunday, August 30th, 6 p.m., come to the Grace Lutheran parking lot, bring a mask and wear it, bring a lawn chair to sit in, bring a drink for yourself and your family members, and we will gather together at a safe distance, look into one another's eyes, and enjoy some good conversation together. Thank you to the Parish Life Committee for putting this together and providing some late refreshments, and I hope to see a lot of you then. On Friday, we had the monthly Grace Food Cupboard giveaway. Thank you to everyone who came out and helped with that, even in the pouring rain. 29 people were given full bags of food, which may not sound like a lot, but this is a ministry we just started a couple of months ago, and it's gradually on the increase, and we hope it grows and grows as other things we have done. So 29 was a significant improvement over last month. And we gave away so much food, we need to restock. So there'll be an email coming out about this. It'll be on the Facebook. But in the meantime, what we need in a word is meat. Obviously, everything we give is canned, non-perishable. So we're talking tuna in pouches or cans, chicken in pouches or cans, Spam, chili, beef stew, baked beans, peanut butter, that sort of thing. That's what we mostly need. So if you're inclined to drop off some food for the giveaway, those are the sort of things we need. Next up on our social concerns calendar is September 11th, the free community meal, which is going to be shepherd's pie and salad this coming month. So the sign-up link is on the web and on the Grace Notes Friday email for that, if you can go to the Sign Up Genius and sign up to help us put that together. And don't forget, the upper room, September, October, is out. If you want to come by and grab one, or we can mail it to you, just let us know in the office. If you have any concerns, if you have any needs, we try to reach out to people, but we don't always get a response. So just know that your church is here for you. And whatever we can possibly help you with, we will call the pastor or call the church. Today we say thank you to Steve Zeminski for our organ and piano, to Bill Koenig for singing our hymns and our special music and serving as our lector. And we also say happy birthday to Bill and Steve, who have a birthday which falls today, the day we're recording. Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you. You probably don't really want to hear me sing, but happy birthday to you. And let us begin. Today's prayer is one that I got from, was shared on a Zoom meeting I was on this week. It was written by Douglas McKelvey, and it talks a little bit about information overload. God, in a world so wired and interconnected, our anxious hearts are pummeled by an endless barrage of troubling news. We are daily aware of more grief, O Lord, than we can rightly consider, of more suffering and scandal than we can respond to, of more hostility, hatred, horror, and injustice than we can engage with compassion. But you, O Jesus, are not disquieted by such news of cruelty and terror and war. You are neither anxious nor overwhelmed. You carried the full weight of the suffering of a broken world when you hung upon the cross, and you carry it still. When the cacophony of universal stress unsettles us, remind us that we are but small and finite creatures never designed to carry the vast abstractions of great burdens, for our arms are too short and our strength is too small. But guard us from shutting down our empathy or walling off our hearts because of the glut of misery that floods our awareness. Give us discernment in the face of troubling news reports. Give us discernment to know when to pray, when to speak out, when to act, and when to simply shut off our screens and our devices and to sit quietly in your presence, casting the burdens of this world upon the strong shoulders of the one who alone is able to bear them up. Amen. And thank you, Douglas McKelvey. I don't know if you all needed to hear that prayer, but I certainly do. We begin with confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation. Amen. Amen. Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sin. Reconciling God, we confess that we do not trust your abundance and we deny your presence in our lives. We place our hope in ourselves and we rely on our own efforts. We fail to believe that you provide enough for all. We abuse your good creation for our own benefit. We fear difference and do not welcome others as you have welcomed us. We sin in thought, word, and deed. By your grace, forgive us. Through your love, renew us. And in your spirit, lead us, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Amen. Beloved of God, by the radical abundance of divine mercy, we have peace with God through Christ Jesus, through whom we have obtained grace upon grace. Our sins are forgiven. Let us live now in hope, for hope does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our gathering hymn is ELW 810, O Jesus, I Have Promised.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, we thank you for your Son, who chose the path of suffering for the sake of the world. Humble us by his example, point us to the path of obedience, and give us strength to follow your commands. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Follow me, I will bring first reading today is from Jeremiah chapter 15, verses 15 to 21. O Lord, remember me and visit me, and bring down retribution for me on my persecutors. In your forbearance, do not take me away. Know that on your account I suffer insult. Your words were found, and I ate them, and your words became to me a joy and the delight of my heart. For I am called by your name, O Lord, God of hosts. I did not sit in the company of merrymakers, nor did I rejoice. Under the weight of your hand I sat alone. You had filled me with indignation. Why is my pain unceasing, my wound incurable, refusing to be healed? Truly, you are to me like a deceitful brook, like waters that fail. Therefore, thus says the Lord, if you turn back, I will take you back, and you shall stand before me. If you utter what is precious and not what is worthless, you shall serve as my mouth. It is they who turn to you, not you who will turn to them. And I will make you to this people a fortified wall of bronze. They will fight against you, but they shall not prevail over you. For I am with you to save and deliver you, says the Lord. I will deliver you out of the hand of the wicked and redeem you from the grasp of the ruthless. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from Romans chapter 12, verses 9 to 21. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We don't have our technical assistant today. Today's gospel is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 16, beginning at the 21st verse. Glory to you, O Lord. From that time on, after Peter confessed that Jesus was the Messiah, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, God forbid it, Lord. This must never happen to you. But Jesus turned to Peter and said, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. Then Jesus told his disciples, if any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of the Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Let us pray. O God, help us to walk upright through the storms of life. Give us strength and grant us grace sufficient for each day, that we may again and again take up our cross and follow your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The last time I preached on these particular texts, late summer 2017, we were dealing with the aftermath of Hurricane Harvey and the devastation it brought to Houston, Texas. My sermon then quoted from an article that read, as of Tuesday, officials said there had already been more than 1 trillion gallons of rain in the Houston area. To put this into perspective, it was like the equivalent of Niagara Falls for 15 days. Same scriptures, different hurricane. Hurricane Laura slammed southern Louisiana early Thursday as a Category 4 storm, one of the most powerful to strike the Gulf Coast in decades. Houston was spared this time around, but downtown Lake Charles, Louisiana was hit with widespread destruction from Laura's devastating winds, although, thank God, the storm surge was not as high as had been predicted. Still, roofs were peeled off, buildings were destroyed, and lampposts were tossed into the streets. The storm packed 150 mile an hour peak winds when it crossed the coast. There is great devastation, and they are expected to be without power for a very long time. It should go without saying, we need to pray for Lake Charles and that region and the people there and send whatever help we can. And a reminder, if you give to Lutheran Disaster Response and designate Hurricane Response United States in the memo line, 100% of what you give goes to help the affected area. And I will be updating our Facebook and sending out an email blast about this soon with more specifics. But let me say again, our prayers are needed, and never discount the power of prayer. The phrase sending thoughts and prayers has been so often used as a band-aid to fix bullet holes that people mock the words now and think them to be meaningless. What good could prayer do? It's just words. Well, I've never experienced a hurricane, but I've had some personal disasters, and one thing I know for sure is that prayer does make a difference, a very big difference. Both the prayers you say and the prayers others lift up on your behalf. So never be afraid to ask someone to pray for you. We have a prayer chain here. Avail yourself of it. Today's readings begin with Jeremiah crying out to God. First, some backstory. Jeremiah was a prophet called to bring a word from the Lord to God's people in Judah. But what a word. He didn't get to be the lift up your heads, everything's going to be okay prophet. No, poor Jeremiah was charged with being the bad news prophet. He had to tell people that with God's approval, the Babylonians were coming, and they were going to unleash a storm on them, overrun their land, take the people into captivity. And also, by the way, Judah, your alliances with Egypt or Assyria or anybody else are going to fail. Only God can save you. The people of Judah, especially their leaders, were not happy to hear God's word through this prophet. Why are you trying to bring everybody down, Jeremiah? Why are you trying to give us this bad news? He was mocked and scorned, beaten and imprisoned. At one point, the king had Jeremiah thrown into a cistern of sewage to be starved to death because he discouraged everyone so much. And you know, how dare you say negative things about our land? But an Ethiopian eunuch came to his aid, and so he was saved. Remember what I said a few weeks ago about the outcasts? As I'm sure I've mentioned before, Jeremiah really hated being a prophet. His life of service to God was a nightmare. He constantly had to give bad news and was hated and persecuted for it. And yet, he was powerless to quit. In one lament, he shouts, "For whenever I speak, I must cry out. I must shout violence and destruction. For the word of the Lord has become for me a reproach and derision all day long. If I say, I will not mention him or speak any more in his name, then within me there is something like a burning fire shut up in my bones. I am weary with holding it in, and I cannot." And in today's passage, why is my pain unceasing, my wound incurable, refusing to be healed? Truly, God, you are to me like a deceitful brook, like waters that fail. Jeremiah is likening God to a liar and a failure. God, why won't you help? You're like deceitful fail water. I always feel bad for Jeremiah. You can't not feel bad for the poor guy. He's got it rough. And I admire his honesty and vulnerability. As a pastor, people often wonder aloud to me why things are the way they are. I do myself. People come to me who have faith, but especially in these days, it's so often a faith under siege. Why did my loved one have to die? Why am I in so much pain? Why can't I find a job? Even why hasn't God taken me yet to be with my beloved spouse and my other loved ones? Why am I still here? And then often they apologize. This may be a very Pennsylvania Dutch trait, but after getting it off their chest, they say, "Oh, Pastor, I'm sorry. You don't want to hear my problems, and I know it's wrong to yell at God or be angry at God." And I tell them, "Well, if you're wrong, you're in good company." And I tell them about Jeremiah. I share with them what is in the Bible other than the little snippets we hear on a Sunday morning. There's so much more in this book. This book, which I'm holding right side up, there is so much more in this book. You see, Jeremiah was overwhelmed by life. The events that happened to him were like an unceasing flood, filled with natural debris, chemicals, and other pollution, waters that fail. I don't know if you feel that way lately, but sometimes I do. I feel like Jeremiah sometimes. I feel like other prophets of the book who have cried out in anguish, "How long, O Lord?" The lesson for me, for you, for all of us, is that Jeremiah never stopped crying out, and God never stopped answering. God took Jeremiah seriously with all his whining and complaints. "Therefore, says the Lord, if you turn back, I will take you back, and you shall stand before me. If you utter what is precious and not what is worthless, you shall serve as my mouth. And I will make you to this people a fortified wall of bronze. They will fight against you, but they shall not prevail. For I am with you to save you and deliver you, says the Lord. I will deliver you out of the hand of the wicked and redeem you from the grasp of the worthless." God does not immediately act to alleviate Jeremiah's suffering or that of the people, but he does promise to deliver and redeem them. We all face deceitful brooks and waters that fail. None of us get out of this life without some suffering. But God is always with us. We must cry out and God will answer. God will answer. Which brings us to the gospel. After Peter confesses that Jesus is the Messiah, Jesus begins to explain what being the Messiah means. And it's not good times ahead, it's suffering and death. When Peter rebukes him, "No way, Jesus, we're not going to let this happen to you." He's accused of setting his mind on human things rather than divine. Well, yeah, come on now, who wants to hear that their Lord and Savior is going to die? No one likes hearing bad news. Peter didn't like it any more than the people in Jeremiah's time liked listening to doom and gloom. We don't like it either. We're human. It's our nature. But through Jesus Christ, We are more than just human. We are saved and redeemed humans. That great Latin phrase from the German theologian, simul justus et peccator. That's because we've been through another kind of flood, a different kind of torrential waters, waters that never fail and a stream that never dries out. I'm talking about baptism. Jesus rebukes Satan, "Get behind me, you stumbling block." What else rebukes Satan? Baptism. Our parents and our sponsors brought us to this water and on our behalf rejected the devil and all the forces that defy God, the powers of this world that rebel against God and the ways of sin that draw us from God. In this water, we are claimed by God, sealed by the Holy Spirit, and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Forever, that means forever. Nothing takes it away. Jesus said, "Those who lose their life for my sake will find it." And that's what happens in baptism. We lose our life and find it. We become dead to sin and alive in Christ. We give away our life and we gain our life. It doesn't entirely make sense from a human point of view. How can water do such great things? This paradox becomes a stumbling block to us. But it's not just water. It's water in the Word. It's God's promise. It's God's way. It may not seem logical to the human mind, but this is indeed how God saves us. These are waters that are never deceitful and never fail. It's the water of life. When you feel like you're drowning in those raging storms, remember, you are baptized. Go wash your hands for 20 seconds and remember your baptism. Amen. Let us continue with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Confident of your care, O Lord, and helped by the Holy Spirit, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. God of faithfulness, you bid your people to follow Jesus. Set the mind of your church on divine things. Grant us trust in you that we lose our lives for the sake of Christ and thereby discover joy in life through him. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of wonder, the earth is yours and all that is in it. As the seasons change, pattern the rhythm of our lives in harmony with all creation. We pray for those suffering from devastating fires in California, hurricanes, and tropical storms in Louisiana. Lord, help us to ease their suffering. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of all nations, you call us to live peaceably with all. Give us ears to hear one another, even those we name as enemies. Fill all of us with mercy and understanding, that we may all advocate and genuinely care for those who are poor and most vulnerable in their communities. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of salvation, you promised to deliver us and you made good on that promise. Give those who suffer a strong sense of your presence and love. Accompany those who are uncertain. Raise the spirits of those who are despairing and heal the sick, especially Dick, Cynthia, Jim, Kathy, Jeanette, Dean, Brian, Betsy, Angie, and Renee. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of community, you call us to rejoice in hope and persevere in prayer. Make this congregation, Grace Lutheran Macungie, a workshop of your love. When we quarrel, bring reconciliation and help us to overcome evil with good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of all grace, you give us everlasting life. In love, we recall your holy ones who now live in your undying light, especially Tom Glaze. In our remembering, give us a foretaste for the feast to come and bring your comfort for Dean and the Glaze family. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor power, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. God, the Creator, Jesus, the Christ, and the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, bless you and keep you in eternal love. Amen. Our sending hymn, ELW 798, Will You Come and Follow Me?
Thank you.
Go in peace. Christ is with you. Thanks be to God.